The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear or dread? The Lord is the refuge and stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? I hope I can make it to the end. I'm already getting drunk on the first verse. Oh, Jesus. When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though a host encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, even then in this I will be confident. One thing have I asked of the Lord, that I will seek, inquire for, and insistently require, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, in His presence, all the days of my life, to behold and to gaze upon the beauty, the sweet attractiveness, and the delightful loveliness of the Lord, and to meditate, consider, and inquire in His temple. For in the day of trouble, He will hide me in His shelter. In the secret place of His tent will He hide me. He will set me high upon a rock. And now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. In His tent I will offer sacrifices and shouting of joy. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. You know, when we talk about shouting with joy in His house, singing praises. You know, when, I don't know about you, but when you realize what this is saying here, how can you not shout with joy? How can you not sing? How can you not rejoice? I mean, this is just amazing. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud, have mercy and be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face, inquire for and require my presence as your vital need. Seek my face. You have said, Lord, seek my face. And my heart says to you, your face, your presence, Lord, will I seek, inquire for, and require of necessity and on the authority of your word. Now, you know, the Bible talks about without faith, it's impossible to please Him. Those who come to Him must believe that He exists and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. That word seek, when you read it in the Amplified, it's really powerful, because seeking is requiring and inquiring. There's two parts of seeking: inquiring of the Lord, and then requiring of necessity and of the authority of His word. Requiring God is a part of seeking Him. When you seek God, you require of God. In other words, you are requiring God to do what He said He would do. Inquire of Him, that means you ask of Him, you consult Him, and then you require of Him. Amen? You can require God to fulfill His promise. When you come to God, you can come boldly to the throne of God's grace to inquire and to require. When you come to the throne, you have a legal right, you have legal access by faith. By His grace, by the blood of Jesus Christ, you have a legal right. God has given us a legal right. We can come boldly. That's what righteousness gives us. The gift of righteousness gives us the ability to come boldly to the throne of God's grace without guilt, without shame, without condemnation, to inquire of Him and to require of Him. You can remind God His word. When I spoke to you last week concerning this year and I gave you all those scriptures, all of that has been put on our website and it's on our Facebook pages. You need to go get the text of what I shared. All the scriptures are there. Keep them before your eyes. I have been reading them and confessing them every single day since then. You need to be doing the same thing. That's what it is to inquire of the Lord and to require of the Lord. You are putting pressure on the Word of God. When the circumstances put pressure on you, you need to turn the tables. When your circumstances are against you, when your circumstances have become your enemy, amen, you need to turn the tables on your circumstances. You need to turn the tables on your enemies. You need to use the Word of God to put pressure on the circumstances by putting pressure on the Word of God. Amen. The pressure, you can put pressure on the Word of God. The Word of God can handle that pressure. It's a strong rock. Amen. It's a strong foundation. It has the ability to carry the weight of the world, the weight of the universe. All things were made by His word. All things are held together by His word. Amen. So you need to put pressure on the Word of God. That is what it means to require of the Lord. So, Lord, I will seek, inquire for, and require of necessity and on the authority of Your word. You can require God of necessity. Lord, I need that word to work for me right now. You promised. That promise is for me right now, today, in this situation, now by faith. Now faith. Amen. Now faith. It's now. Not tomorrow, not later. It's now. Amen. It's now. Now I require Your word to work in this situation. I require Your word to manifest in this situation. I require that the situations and circumstances will turn around, will line up with what Your word says. Everything that is not in line, according to Your promise, according to Your will, according to Your word, I command it to be, to change right now and to line up. Lord, I am requiring of necessity right now. I need that word to work for me right now. Right now, in Jesus' name, I take a hold of that. I take hold of it firmly, holding fast, holding firmly to the confession of faith. Amen. I am confessing right now by faith that this word is real. This word is true. This word is above every situation and circumstance. This word is about what I see. This word is about what I feel. This word is about what I hear. Amen. What I'm experiencing here, what surrounds me, is lying to me. It is not real. It is temporary. What is real is the word. The truth is above the facts. Amen. What is permanent is God's word. And so I am requiring right now of necessity and on the authority of Your word. That is how you seek God. Amen. That is how you seek God. You don't just seek God, you know, I'm just seeking You, Lord. That's a part of it. You worship, you come into His presence, but then you've got to start speaking the word. You've got to start. He says, "You have said, seek My face. Inquire for and require My presence as your vital need." Lord, I require Your presence. Lord, I require Your word to work for me. Lord, I require that You prosper me. Lord, I require that You bless me. Amen. Some years ago, there was a guy in the church. He left, and his complaint was that we are ordering God around. How can you order God around when you speak? Lord, heal people. You can't tell God what to do. No, you can. According to His word, you can. That's how the Bible is. Read your Bible. What are you talking about? I guess you haven't read your Bible. Amen. Read your Bible. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus said, speak to this mountain. Amen. Hallelujah. You speak to the mountain in the name of Jesus. Amen. You command healing. You command prosperity. Hallelujah. You command. You require the word of God to work. God's not nervous. God's not going to get all upset and nervous when you require Him to fulfill His word. He actually says, oh, wow, look at this. Finally, I found somebody with faith on the earth that is believing Me. Amen. And He begins to move on your behalf. Hallelujah. He begins to do exploits on the behalf of those who believe Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So you require Him of necessity and of the authority of Your word. So if we just stop here, just go to Hebrews. And I'll read that same verse again, just so that you see in chapter 11 and verse 6. But without faith, again, I'm reading from the Amplified. So without faith, It is impossible to please and be satisfactory to him, for whoever would come near to God must necessarily believe that God exists and that he's a rewarder of those who earnestly and diligently seek him out. Okay? So that word to seek is to inquire of and to require. Amen? Is to inquire of and require. You can require God to do his word. You can say, God, you promised. This is what your word says. And by faith right now, I am calling that to come to pass in my life in Jesus' name. I am requiring the word of God to be fulfilled. I am requiring the word of God to manifest. I am requiring your promise to come to pass. I am requiring everything to turn around, to line up according to your word. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Okay? Hallelujah. You have said, seek my face, inquire for and require my presence as your vital need. My heart says to you, your face, your presence, Lord, I will seek, inquire for, and require of necessity and on the authority of your word. When you come to fellowship with someone, you don't just sit there and just stare at them. You talk. So when you come to God's presence and now you're face to face with him, that's the perfect opportunity to speak. Amen. Let him speak to you and you speak as well. What do you speak? What you speak is you inquire of the Lord. You're asking the Lord. Inquiring means, Lord, speak to me about what to do. Speak to me. Show me the way to go. Show me your ways. Amen. Show me your will. Lead me and guide me in the path that I should go. What is it that you require of me? Amen. Because God's going to require something of you. What is that? Obedience. And guess what? God is also required to obey his word. If he spoke it, he's required by his own law to fulfill it. He's not going to back down. He's not a man that he should lie, and neither is he the son of man that he should repent. He's not going to change. Repent means to change. He's not going to change his mind about what he said. Amen. So you can say, Lord, you said in your word that if I confess with my mouth, Jesus is Lord, and if I believe in my heart, God raised him from the dead, I will be saved. That's how we start the altar call prayers, right? That means we're coming to God based on his word, because he said. I didn't say, he said. Some denomination didn't say, he said in his word, that if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And so, Father, I come to you right now based on that. I repent of my sin. I confess Jesus as Lord. Come into my heart right now. Take out the stony heart. Put in a heart of flesh. Wash me, cleanse me, fill me, change me. Let me never be the same again. I turn my back on the world. I turn my back on sin. And I will follow you, Lord Jesus, all the days of my life. I confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. He is my Lord. He is my Savior. And from this day forward, I will never be the same again in Jesus' name. That is a confession of faith. By confessing Jesus as Lord, that's how you're saved. You believe in your heart, you confess with your mouth. Amen. With the heart, you believe, and with the mouth, you confess. That's how you receive. That's how you require, based on his word. Amen. Amen. Now, let's continue to read. Hallelujah. Verse 9, hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. You who have been my help, cast me not off, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation. Well, he's not going to forsake you. He's not going to hide his face from you. Amen. He's not going to turn you away in anger. He's going to help you. He's not going to cast you off. He promised. Although my father and my mother have forsaken me, even when your own father and your mother have forsaken you, yet the Lord will take me up, adopt me as his child. People, do you realize you've been adopted into the family of God? You're not an orphan. You're not an orphan. Do you understand me? You're not motherless. You're not fatherless. You're not an orphan. Amen? A lot of people in the church have an orphan spirit. You know, they don't realize that they've been adopted. That's why they find it very hard to connect. People who have not grown up in close families, they have a hard time connecting in relationships. You know, they have a real hard time. But when you have a strong relationship with God, you're gonna be able to connect with others. Amen. I'll never forget years ago when I was first starting out in the ministry, I was talking to a pastor. He had been pastoring for many years and in several nations. And I asked him, I said, you know, if you got just a couple of minutes, give me a nugget. Give me a nugget about the ministry. Give me a nugget of truth, you know. Give me some wisdom about the ministry. And he said to me this, if you're ever starting to feel insecure, that means your relationship with God is not strong enough. He said, especially in ministry, because you'll be criticized a lot, you'll come under attack a lot, people will, you know, say stuff about you, and you'll begin to take it personally, and you'll begin to feel, and if it's starting to affect you, if the criticism is starting to affect you, it's because you're insecure. And the reason you're insecure is because you're not close to God as you should be. When you're not as close to God as you should be, you're going to be very insecure. Because if you're really close to God, if you're really seeking Him, if you're really in His presence, that His love, I'll tell you what, His love is going to quiet you. His love is going to wash over you. His love is going to strengthen you. His joy is going to strengthen you. His joy is going to well up in you as a well of water. And His peace is going to overwhelm you, protecting your heart and your mind. Amen. And you're going to know that you are secure. You're going to know that you're the righteousness of God in Christ. You're going to know that He loves you. You're going to know that He's pleased with you. Amen. You're going to hear the Father saying, this is my beloved son. This is my beloved daughter in whom I am well pleased. And in that moment, you are secure. It doesn't matter what anybody says. It doesn't even matter if they want to take you and throw you off of a cliff. You'll walk right through it. And you'll go on your way, fulfilling your mission, fulfilling your calling, because you know that you are secure in God. But how do you become secure in Christ? By being close to Him, by seeking Him, by inquiring of Him and requiring Him and being in His presence. Amen. Although my father and my mother have forsaken me, yet the Lord will take me up, adopt me as a child. Teach me your way, O Lord. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a plain and even path because of my enemies, those who lie in wait for me. Teach me your way, O Lord. That's a part of inquiring. Teach me your way, O Lord. Lead me. Lead me in a plain and even path. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, to false witnesses, for false witnesses have risen up against me, and they breed out cruelty and violence. Anybody ever had that? False witnesses have risen up against you? Well, that's on a daily basis for me, okay? Because people don't like what I preach, people don't like the ministry, people don't like joy, they don't like the preaching on prosperity, all this other stuff, and they rise up against you, constantly criticizing. Amen. And I just basically don't care about what they think. But if I cared about what they thought, I would fall apart. I would back down because I would be insecure in who I am and what God's called me to do. And also, I would be insecure in the Word. You see, I am not insecure about the Word. I am confident. You see, faith is a confidence. Of this, I am confident. I am confident in this Word. I am not doubting this Word. Amen. I am confident in His Word. When I read my Bible, I don't read it with doubt. I read it with faith. And I am confident in His Word. So when I preach His Word, it is His Word. And He backs up His Word. He watches over His Word to perform it. I don't have to perform it. He's going to perform it. I require Him to perform His Word when I preach it with faith. That was the revelation T.L. Osborne got. When he first launched out into the ministry, he went to India as a missionary. T.L. and Daisy Osborne gone home to be with the Lord. Amazing apostles, missionaries, evangelists. And then they failed in their ministry. They didn't even convert one person. They were, you know, basically just, you know, discouraged and defeated. And they went back to America. And then one day he was in a preacher's convention, sitting way up, way, way, way up in the back of the auditorium, almost in the back row, and there was a man preaching, and that day it was just like the heavens opened. God came and just almost like smacked him. The Holy Ghost almost like smacked him and said, why are you so in so much despair? Why are you so discouraged? You don't believe my word. You don't trust that I will perform my word. And at that moment, he just had this encounter with God that just absolutely changed his life, that shook him. Power of God came upon him, and he just got a revelation. He got a revelation that it was like It was like he knew the word, but he didn't like really believe it. He didn't like deep down inside, he didn't really believe that God was going to do what he said he would do. It was just like, it was just that moment of total shaking. It was just a moment of, and then from that moment on, he knew that if you just stood in front of people and he preached his word, that he knew that he knew if he could just get an audience with people, and people would hear him, miracles will begin to pop like popcorn, and there will be the supernatural manifested, and signs and wonders and miracles and healings would take place. And later on, I heard him in person stand up and said that when he had all those crusades in Africa, and he was basically a pioneer of crusade evangelism. He was one of those first evangelists that started to go and have those open-air crusades, especially in Africa, in the 50s, okay? Before anybody else was doing it. Now, everybody's doing it, you know. But before anybody else was doing it, he was the one doing it, and had never been done before. People would like preach in churches or just small meetings, but he would just go to these big, big open-air campaigns with hundreds of thousands of people, and he would stand up on the stage and proclaim the gospel. And he said that he knew in his heart that if he would just open his mouth, if he could just have the opportunity to preach the word, that he knew signs and wonders and miracles would break out, and the supernatural will be made manifest. And that if he would just proclaim healing in the mighty name of Jesus, those who would hear him would be healed. If he would proclaim miracles, he knew in his heart that those who heard him would receive miracles. And if he called people to salvation, he knew that those who heard him would come and receive salvation. So something happened in him. Faith exploded on the inside of him. He got a hold of the concept of faith, that what it is to believe God, inquire of and require his word. Amen. If I'm preaching the word, I am requiring God to perform that word. Jesus said, go preach the word. I'll be with you. I'll work with you. And I'll confirm the word with signs following. We must believe that God will confirm his word. The word that you speak will be confirmed. Take the word I gave you. Take that text from last week. Confess it every day. Proclaim it. Believe it. Speak it. Memorize it. Let it get into your bones. Let it be like fire shut up in your bones. And then let it come out of your mouth like fire. If the word is not in your bones like fire, it's not going to come out of your mouth like fire. If you want the word to come out of your mouth like fire, it's got to go into your bones like a fire. First, it's got to manifest in you before it can manifest through you. Greater the manifestation of God to you, greater the manifestation of God through you. Amen. Greater the touch of God in you, the greater the touch of God through you. You cannot give what you don't have. And you cannot take people where you have not been yourself. It's got to be real to you. When it's real to you, it'll be real through you. And when it's real to you, it'll really, really, really change your life. Amen. So inquire of the Lord and require him. You can stand boldly before God and proclaim his word and require God to perform his word. That's the definition of biblical faith. Not just that I believe, but that I speak because I believe. That's the spirit of faith. Amen. Hallelujah. We speak, right? What do we speak? We speak God's word. We believe, therefore we speak. That's the definition of biblical faith. You must believe it and you must speak it. The word of God must be in your mouth, not just in your heart. Put it in your heart, but then also put it in your mouth. Hallelujah. And then here we come to verse 13. What would have become of me had I not believed that I would see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living? What would have become of me? What would have become of me if I had not believed I would see your goodness? I would have despaired unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Say this after me. Lift your hands. Say, I would have despaired unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Lord, I thank you. This year, in 2017, I believe that I will see your goodness. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Of this I am confident, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And Ivy says, I remain confident of this. Say this after me. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. That's what it says. I will wait for the Lord. Say this after me. I will wait for the Lord. I will be strong. I will take heart. I will wait for the Lord. Hallelujah. Of this I am confident, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I mean, I've just been saying this like every day. I've been saying this like 10 times a day. I've been saying this like 20 times a day. Amen. New King James says, I would have lost heart. I'm not going to lose heart. You know why? You're not going to lose heart. You know why? You know why? Because you believe that you will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Walk around every day saying, Lord, thank you. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I will see. I will see. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Of this I am confident. That means I'm not shaken. I'm not shaken. Remember? An unshakable. We looked at that last week. Unshakable. An unshakable faith. Holding firmly, holding fast. Not being shaken by circumstances and situations. Holding fast, holding firmly to the word of life. Holding fast, holding firmly to hope, to the confession of hope. You've got to confess hope every day. Confess hope every day. Don't ever, ever, never ever confess hopelessness. Never ever. Don't give the devil the pleasure. Don't despair. Don't despair. Don't get hopeless. Every day proclaim hope. Every day holding fast, holding firmly to the confession of hope. Thank you, Lord. I am hopeful. You know what hope is? It's a good expectation. Amen. You're expecting good things every day. You know why? Because you will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. He will make all of his goodness to pass before you. He'll proclaim his name before you. He will be glorified in you, and you will be glorified in him. Amen. So speak that every day. Speak that every day. This year, it's so vital. I just feel that it's so vital this year that you do not lose heart ever. You don't ever despair. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Because I would have despaired unless I had believed I see your goodness. I would have despaired unless I had believed I see your glory. For your word says, you promised that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. For your word says, you promised that if I will seek your face, if I inquire of and require of you, you will answer. You will not cast me away. Even if my father and my own mother desert me, you will never desert me. You will never cast me away. You'll be with me. I belong to you. You belong to me. Hallelujah. You are my Lord, and I am your child. You are my Father. You love me. I am your son. I'm your daughter. I love you. I'm close to you. I belong to you. We have a relationship. We are family. I don't have a religion. I have a relationship. It's not about me being required to do certain rules and regulations. It's about me just being in your presence, seeking your presence, seeking your face. Thank you, Jesus. So do not lose heart. Believe that you will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. What does it mean to wait on the Lord? What does it mean to wait on the Lord? Waiting on the Lord means speaking His word, confessing in faith and confessing in hope, and waiting for the manifestation of it. When waiting on the Lord means you can't just wait on the Lord without doing anything. You speak His word, you believe His word, you stand on His word. That's how you wait on the Lord. You're waiting on the Lord while you're believing His promise. You're waiting on the Lord while you're speaking His promise. You're waiting on the Lord while you're confessing the promise. You're waiting on the Lord while you're inquiring and requiring of Him based on His word. That's how you wait on the Lord. Amen. Be of good courage, and He shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. That's how you wait on the Lord. While you wait on the Lord, you're being of good courage. That's how you wait on the Lord. In a hopeful expectation. Amen. Expecting good things to happen. Expecting a miracle every day. Expecting provision every day. Expecting prosperity every day. Every day you wake up, you speak that into your life. Today is a day filled with your provision. Today is a day filled with your goodness being manifested to me. Thank you, Lord. Today is a day filled with the supernatural. Today is a day where your angels will surround me. Today is a day where you will perform your word that you spoke over my life. Today is a day that will be overflowing with prosperity, divine provision. Today is a day it will be overflowing with wisdom and divine protection. Everywhere I go, everywhere where my feet land upon, you have given unto me. Hallelujah. I am blessed going and I'm blessed coming out. I am hopeful today. Today is going to be a great day. Today is going to be a day filled with victory. Today is going to be a day filled with your provision. Today is going to be a day filled with the supernatural. Today is going to be a day filled with signs and wonders and miracles where you will manifest your goodness in my life in a visible, tangible, real way. Speak that every day. Start your day every day by speaking that. Today I am healed from the top of my head down to the soles of my feet. Today people are looking for me to give me things to people. I'm not looking for clients. Clients are looking for me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Today I'm not looking for money. Money is looking for me. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Today I'm not looking for a job. A job is looking for me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Today I have favor with both God and man. Everywhere I go, I am highly favored of the Lord. I have favor everywhere I go. I have favor everywhere I go. Confess favor. I have favor in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Favor is better than money many times. Favor will get you things money cannot get you. So confess favor and then confess some money too. It's also good to have the money. Have the favor and the money. Hallelujah. So you will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And how does God manifest His goodness? There are two ways that God manifests His goodness: through giving, through His generosity, and through His forgiving. Amen. So God's going to give you good things this year. It's His good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Expect good things to happen. Amen. Don't get caught up in all the bad stuff that's going on around you and get sucked into that. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. People just need to get... People need to change their expectations. My God, I'm sitting there getting ready for Bible school, and there's a pastor's forum on WhatsApp, and boom, boom, it's buzzing, buzzing, buzzing. And I usually hardly just ever say anything, and I just read it and see what's going on. And God, pastors are talking to each other. The weather's so bad. Maybe we should cancel church tomorrow. Who's canceling church tomorrow? And one guy says, we're canceling church. Another one says, I guess we'll cancel it too if you're canceling. I mean, come on, man. And then after four people canceled, the one who started the conversation said, okay, since all four of you are canceling services on Sunday, well, we'll cancel ours too. And then some guy writes and says, well, God bless you anyways without a service. No. No. You know what? No. Actually, no. And at that moment, I got fed up and I said, you know what? The blessing is when you come and worship Him The blessing is when you come and press in. Blessing is not just some cheap thing he throws out to anybody. Blessing, you got to contend for the blessing. You got to listen. You got to inquire of him. You got to seek his face. And you got to require him to perform his word. It's not just going to come and happen to anybody. You better press in. And I wrote and I said, we don't cancel nothing for anything. And we're pressing in tomorrow. Because I'm planning to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I'm not looking at the snow. I'm expecting good things to happen today. This is going to be my best day. Why should it be your worst day? Don't look at the weather and say, ah, this is just a bad day. No. Why? Maybe you're going to end up missing out on the best day ever that God planned for your life. You need to say, this is my best day. Some idiot wrote and said 2016 was the worst year ever. Really? I guess you didn't live during the time of the bubonic plague 100 years ago when a third of the population of the world died from the Black Death. I guess you didn't live in the middle of World War II when over 50 million people died in a six-year war. Come on, man. This wasn't the worst year. What are you talking about? People just dumb. And how dumb can you get and still breathe? Amen. I'm expecting to see the goodness of the Lord. I'm expecting to see the goodness of the Lord. I'm expecting to see the goodness of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Do all things without complaining and murmuring, right? We saw that. And then you'll see the goodness of the Lord. When you wait upon the Lord, don't do it with a complaining, murmuring, whining attitude. Do it with a hopeful attitude, confessing faith, confessing hope, believing God, expecting to see good things, and speaking that. That's how you wait on the Lord. And then he will come. He will show up just in time. Amen. Never too early, never too late, but right on time, he will be there. He will be there right on time. Expect that to happen. Expect that to happen. Don't lose heart. Be of good cheer. Be of good courage. Amen. You will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Don't despair. Don't despair. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He set a table for us in the presence of our enemies. He said, come and dine. Come and dine. That table represents his goodness. Amen. And he will fulfill the good pleasure of his goodness. Amen. It's his good pleasure to manifest his goodness in your life. It gives God pleasure because you know why? He's good. Because his character is good. When he expresses his goodness, it gives him good pleasure. Amen. God's love is perfected in his giving. A love that doesn't give is not perfect love. And what does the Bible say? Perfect love casts out all fear. What is perfect love? God giving. God so loved the world perfectly that he gave his son. Will he not freely give you all things in Christ? If he's already given you his son, his best gift, will he not freely give you all things? Will he not freely give you all things? Notice sometimes the Bible asks a question and doesn't answer the question. You know why? Because God wants you to answer the question. Because it's your faith answering the question. He's checking to see if you have faith. Do you believe it? Will he not freely give you all things? That's a question. What's the answer? What's the answer, church? What's the answer? Let me hear you. What's the answer? Yes, he will. You need to say, yes, he will freely give me all things. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I know the answer. And that's my answer. Yes, Lord, here I am. You said, will you find faith on the earth? Here's one right now. I believe it. And you need to be very determined that you need to be determined saying that even if I'm the last person on the planet to believe the word, I will believe the word. If they kill a billion people, if the Antichrist would somehow to come, and if they would kill a billion people for believing the Bible, will you still believe the Bible? If you're the last one remaining, and they bring you before the Antichrist, or whoever Christ, Antichrist represents, whoever represents the Antichrist, they bring you before him, say, deny the word and we'll let you live. Huh? What are you going to do? Are you going to deny the word just so you can survive? Or are you going to say, just go ahead and kill me too because I also believe? Amen. Come on now. It might have to come to that. It might have to come to that. People are dying for their faith right now as we speak all over the world in different places. Places like North Korea, where it's even illegal, punishable by death to have a Bible. But yet, the underground church is growing. Please. So, we should have no excuse. We should have no excuses. Amen. Because people are paying a higher price for their faith in Christ. Why should we pay a lower price, huh? When we get to heaven, are we going to have to look at those people and go, man, they just loved God more than I did. That's terrible. I don't want to be able to say that, man. You know what? Those people, they just loved God more than, there's Stephen, he just loved God more than I did. No. I don't want to say Stephen loved God more than I did. I want to love God just as much as Stephen loved God. Amen. So as you're tested, hold on. Hold on to the word of life. Hold on to the promises. Hold on to the confession of faith. Hold on to hope. And don't give up. Don't give up. Don't be moved by circumstances. Don't go by what you hear or see. What you feel. Every day expect good things to happen. And watch and see how God will just increase the prosperity in your life. You don't prosper by complaining and whining. God, why does he have it and I don't? Give it to me as well. You don't get things from God by throwing a temper tantrum. We taught our daughter, you don't get things from us by throwing a temper tantrum. You only get a spanking. You want to get things from me? You get them by faith and obedience. Go clean your room, then you'll get it. Go do your homework, then you'll get it. Go take your bath. Go brush your teeth. Go eat your lunch. Then you'll get it. Obey. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You don't want your kids growing up and getting everything they want. You will not do that. You get a spanking. I'll put your flesh under. You're not going to whine and cry and throw a temper, throw a fit to get what you want. But that's how the world is now. The modern day, especially this new generation, these millennials, they just are used to getting their way. And if they don't get their way, they just like whiny babies. 20-somethings, they're like whining like babies. I didn't get what I want. Would you like some hot chocolate? And they're giving them little, they call them, comfort puppies. That's unbelievable. This is university students in America. They have these puppies. So if they feel they didn't get what they want, they can just go there and hold a puppy in a safe zone. And everybody, even the last place, gets a medal, participation medal. Good job. You participated. No, you came last. You sucked. You shouldn't get anything for coming last. We're teaching people that it's okay to come last. It's not okay to come last. It's just okay. As long as you participated. No. Run your race and finish your race and come ahead. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Always, you should always aim to be the best. So we got all these people coming up who just think that it's okay as long as I try. No, it's not okay as long as you try. You need to do a better job. You need to do a better job. Amen. Amen. Jesus said, if they ask you to walk 1 mile, you walk 2 miles. Amen. Amen. The 2 mile principle means you always got to give 200%. Not come and do a halfway job. I tried. I should get a medal. I should get a pat on the back. No, you shouldn't get a pat on the back for trying. You should do a better job. Amen. Amen. So, we're losing all of this stuff about, you know, wanting to achieve things in life and succeed and improve and do a better job every time and seek for perfection. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Our God is perfect. And he gives us perfect gifts. So why should we take perfect gifts and do sloppy halfway jobs with them? Take the perfect gift and do a perfect job with the gift. Amen. We should always look to do a perfect job on everything we do. Amen. And not get all upset because you got a rebuke. People don't want to take a rebuke anymore. Amen. Hallelujah. Take a rebuke. Take a rebuke. Amen. Swallow your pride and figure out what you got to do with it. Amen. Hallelujah. We're getting something about to all open up a whole new can of worms here. All right. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes God's love comes in an open rebuke, okay? Open rebuke is better than hidden love. Love is not always this mushy-gushy, canım cicim. Sometimes love is a rebuke, and God does come to correct you. Say, hey, shape up, fix that. Many times he's rebuked me. I'm glad he did. Hallelujah. Take the rebuke. Do something with it. Amen. Change. And do better. Improve. Seek perfection. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Like I said, he also requires something of us too. Coming to the Lord, seeking the Lord. Amen. Inquiring and requiring. And he requires from us obedience. You may not be perfect, but you can have perfect obedience. Amen. That's all he's looking for, is perfect obedience. When you have perfect obedience, you are perfect. When you're doing what he's asked you to do, when you're correcting the things he wants you to correct, then you are perfect. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Is this helping anybody here today? Yes. Say this again. I am confident in this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I will wait on the Lord. I'll be of good courage. He shall strengthen my heart. I'll wait on the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.